this morning follows a historic day in America and across the globe. God's word makes it clear that those who inhabit thrones of self-righteousness will eventually be toppled by the divine powers of justice. And those whose unrepentant hearts are bent on evil will face a judgment day. As John writes in Revelation, the kingdoms of this earth will become the kingdoms of our God and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. And Jesus is alive, and he has conquered sin, and he will outlive and overcome all reigns of evil once and for all. And it's his resurrection that we have celebrated and continue to celebrate. As a matter of fact, in some parts of the Christian church, the 40 days following Easter are days of celebration and great joy. Eastertide is a season when sorrowing and remorse are replaced with gladness and continual thanksgiving. Fasting is replaced with feasting, and silence is replaced with robust hymns of praise. Upon meeting a fellow Christian during Eastertide, one greets another with the proclamation, "Christ is risen," and the responder replies, "Truly, he is risen." Let's try it. Christ is risen.
Truly, he is risen.
Let's do it again. Christ is risen.
Truly, he is risen.
Please pray with me. God Almighty, we praise your holy name in this joyful Eastertide. We thank you, Lord, because through your death and resurrection, we have won the victory through your redeeming love and grace. Loving Savior, fill us. Fill us with new life so that we may love one another and do what you want us to do in sharing your love with those who don't know you. And it's in Jesus' powerful name that we pray. Amen.
You are about to hear "Christ is Risen" proclaimed in 31 of the over 50 languages spoken by the Biola community, 31 of the 7,000 languages spoken in our world. Christianity is ranked as the largest religion in the world today with approximately 2 billion believers. Christianity is a way of life for people from many tongues and tribes and nations.
Hindi, Ishu Zinda Hai.
Arabic, Masih Qam.
Bil Hakika Qam.
Igbo, Christ e biliwo. Language Yoruba, Christi ti jinde.
Mandarin, Yesu fu huola.
Spanish, Jesus ha resucitado.
Kazakh, Christos terodi nindal terodi.
Es verdad, Cristo ha resucitado.
Korean, 우리 주님은 부활하셨고
지금도 살아계십니다.
Hebrew, Mashiach Yeshua Kam, Hallelujah.
Sinhala, Unuhanse Malungen Nagitiseka.
Russian, Isus Vaskies, Vaistinu Vaskies.
Indonesian, Christus Telah Bangkit.
Javanese, Gusti Sampun Gramaka.
Ukrainian, Christus Vaskres.
German, Jesus is Auferstanden.
Tokpizen, Jesus Ikarapinis through. Kenya Rwanda, Yesu Yazutse.
Mairasi, Yesus Nyan Na Erene. Now another language, Cebuano. Nabanhaunasya. Another language, Tagalog. Nabuhay Muling Sya.
Japanese, Kristo Ayomingaerareta.
Swedish, Yesus Erupstanden.
Kiswahili, Kristo Amefufuka.
Amefufuka kweli.
And also in Kimbere, Christo nemurioku.
Zulu, Jesu uvukile. And Afrikaans, Christus het opgestaan.
Fulfulde, Isa umiti. And also in Mafa, Yesu ntamarkarauda.
Luganda, Yesu azuki dedara.
Czech, Christus vstal z mrtvých.
Will you please stand and join me in singing, "Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing."
Oh,
gracious master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of your name. Jesus, the name that charms our fears, that beats our sorrows cease. This music in the sinner's ear, 'tis life and health and peace. He breaks the power of cancelled sin, he sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean, his blood availed for me. Hear him, ye deaf, his praise ye dumb, your loosened tongues employ. In line behold your Savior come, and leap ye in for joy.
You may be seated.
The Bible says, my King is the King of the Jews. He's the King of righteousness. He's the King of the ages. He's the King of heaven. He's the King of glory. He's the King of kings, and he's the Lord of lords. That's my King. I wonder, do you know him? My King is a sovereign King. He's enduringly strong. He's entirely sincere. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's imperially powerful. He's impartially merciful. Do you know him? He's God's son. He's a sinner's savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. He is the loftiest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's the miracle of the age. He's the only one qualified to be an all-sufficient savior. I wonder if you know him today. He supplies strength for the weak. He sympathizes and he saves. He strengthens and sustains. He guards and he guides. He heals the sick. He cleanses the lepers. He forgives sinners. He discharges debtors. He delivers the captives. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. And he beautifies the meek. I wonder if you know him. Well, he's the key to knowledge. He's the wellspring of wisdom. He's the doorway of deliverance. He's the pathway of peace. He's the roadway of righteousness. He's the highway of holiness. He's the gateway of glory. Do you know him? Well, his office is manifold. His promise is sure. His life is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. And his yoke is easy. And his burden is light. I wish I could describe him to you. He's invincible. He's irresistible. Well, you can't get him out of your mind. You can't get him off of your hands. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. Well, the Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found out they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't find any fault in him. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him, and the grave couldn't hold him. Yeah!
Thank you.
hatred let me so love, where there is injury, pardon, where there is doubt, faith, where there is despair, hope, where there is darkness, light, where there is sadness, joy. Oh, divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to
When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Peter replied, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said, Feed my lambs. A second time Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter answered, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And Jesus said, Take care of my sheep. The third time Jesus said to Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, Do you love me? Peter said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Then Jesus said to him, Follow me.
And 50 years ago, Northeast India was known as Assam, where headhunters determine a man's strength and ability to protect his wife by the number of heads he amassed. Into this hostile and aggressive community came a group of Welsh missionaries spreading the message of love, peace, and hope found in Jesus Christ. One of the missionaries succeeded in converting a man, his wife, and two children. This man's faith proved contagious, and many villagers began to accept Christ. Angry, the village chief summoned all the villagers together. He then called the family who had converted to renounce their faith in public or face martyrdom. Filled with the Holy Spirit, the Christian convert opened his mouth and began to sing this song.
Decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back.
With me.
Though none go with me, still I'll follow.
They will lay their hands on you and persecute you, delivering you to the synagogues and prisons, bringing you before kings and governors for my name's sake. It will lead to an opportunity for your testimony. So make up your minds not to prepare beforehand to defend yourselves, for I will give you utterance and wisdom which none of your opponents will be able to resist or refute. But you will be betrayed even by parents and brothers and relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death, and you will be hated by all because of my name.
More Christians have been and are being persecuted and martyred for their faith in the 20th and 21st centuries than in all previous centuries combined. Nearly two-thirds of all Christians alive in the world today suffer persecution in various degrees. Over 500 Christians are martyred every day for their faith in Christ. So the stories you're about to hear are some of the most riveting accounts of Christians who have died for the cause of Christ in the past 70 years. They come from all sectors of Christ's church. It's fascinating to discover how similar their desires and passions were for serving Christ, not only their insatiable hunger to live for him, but also their desire and their willingness to die for him.
Maximilian Kolbe, Poland, 1941. At the end of July 1941, three prisoners disappeared from Auschwitz, prompting the camp commander to pick 10 men to be starved to death in an underground bunker in order to deter further escape attempts. When one of the selected victims cried out, "My wife, my children," Maximilian Kolbe, a Catholic priest, broke rank and volunteered to die in his place. From the hour that Father Kolbe descended into the starvation bunker, a great change came over that horrible place. The wailing and cries of suffering were now converted into prayers and hymns. "Never before," said the guards, "had we seen anything like this." When they made their morning rounds at the bunker to remove corpses, they found Father Kolbe in prayer, peaceful and fully conscious. His face radiated light. Because Kolbe went on living after the others had died, an executioner finally gave Kolbe a lethal injection of carbolic acid. Kolbe said, "I would like to use myself completely up in the service of Christ and to disappear without leaving a trace as the winds carry my ashes to the far corners of the world." Dietrich Bonhoeffer, Germany, 1945. On the morning of April 9th, 1945, German pastor Dietrich Bonhoeffer was hung at Flossenbürg concentration camp. The camp doctor reported, "Just before the execution, I saw Pastor Bonhoeffer kneeling on the floor, praying fervently to God. I have hardly ever seen a man die so entirely submissive to the will of God." Dietrich Bonhoeffer was known for his leadership role in the Confessing Church, his efforts on behalf of peace and injustice, his fierce opposition to the Nazis and anti-Semitism, and his writings on theology and ethics have been influential far beyond his German Lutheran context. In his book, The Cost of Discipleship, Bonhoeffer wrote, "When Christ calls a man, he bids him to come and die. It is the same death every time. Death in Jesus Christ, the death of the old man at his call." Jim Elliot, Ecuador, 1956. Jim Elliot, a missionary to Ecuador, was killed along with his four colleagues while attempting to evangelize the violent Aka Indians. The missionaries were speared to death on January 8th, 1956. Jim and his friends became instantly known worldwide as martyrs when Life magazine told the story of their mission and death. Shortly thereafter, Elizabeth Elliot and some of the other missionary widows began working among the Aka Indians, where they had a profound impact and witnessed many members of the tribe embrace Christianity. In his journal, Jim wrote these following words: "He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to give up what he cannot lose. Father, take my life, yes, my blood, if thou wilt, and consume it with thine enveloping fire. I would not save it, for it is not mine to save. Have it all, Lord. Pour out my life as an oblation to the world. Make me thy fuel, flame of God." Martin Luther King Jr., USA, 1968. Martin Luther King Jr. was a Baptist pastor, activist, prominent leader in the African-American civil rights movement. He was an iconic figure who used nonviolent methods following the teachings of Christ. King was a heroic leader in the American movement, and with his vision on a many-colored nation with justice for all. Early on, he established his reputation as one of the greatest orators in American history. In 1964, King became the youngest person to receive the Nobel Peace Prize for his work to end racial segregation and discrimination through civil disobedience. Reverend King was martyred on April 4th, 1968. Dr. King said, "Like anybody, I would like to live a long life, but I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will, and he's allowed me to go up to the mountain, and I've looked over it, and I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know that we, as a people, will get to the promised land." Jahani Luam, Uganda, 1977. In 1974, Jahani Luam became Anglican Archbishop of Uganda and Rwanda. It was a time of widespread terror. In 1977, Archbishop Luam called on President Idi Amin and delivered a note of protest against Amin's policies of arbitrary killings and the unexplained disappearances of thousands. In return, Amin accused Archbishop Luam of treason and had him arrested. Amin asked, "What shall we do with this traitor?" His soldiers replied, "Kill him now." Archbishop Luam was taken to army barracks, where he prayed for his tormentors as he was undressed, thrown to the floor, whipped, and then shot twice in the chest. To this day, he remains one of the most influential spiritual leaders of the modern church in Africa. Early in his life, he made this declaration: "I am prepared to die in the army of Jesus. As Jesus shed his blood for people, if it is God's will, I will do the same." Oscar Romero, El Salvador, 1980. As the Archbishop of San Salvador during El Salvador's brutal civil war, Oscar Romero became the Bishop of the Poor. For his work defending the Salvadorian people, Romero was a surprise in history. The poor never expected him to take their side, and the elites of church and state felt betrayed. After calling for international intervention to protect those being killed by government forces, Romero was assassinated on March 24, 1980. Romero promised that life, not death, would have the last word. "I do not believe in death without resurrection," he said. "If they kill me, I will be resurrected in the Salvadorian people. Martyrdom is a grace of God that I do not deserve. But if God accepts the sacrifice of my life, let my blood be a seed of freedom. A bishop will die, but the church of God, which is the people, will never perish." Alexander Men, Russia, 1993. Before glasnost and perestroika had become bywords on nightly news, Father Men was known across Soviet Russia as a beacon of evangelical reform. In his humble church in a Moscow suburb, where intelligentsia flocked, even unlettered workers could understand his plain sermons and presentations of the gospel. Men was the spiritual advisor to the novelist Alexander Solzhenitsyn, as well as the physicist Andrei Sokharov, both of whom would be Nobel Prize winners. The night before Men was struck from behind with an axe, he gave a lecture in Moscow with these words at its very heart: "No living creature except for man is able to take a risk, and even the risk of death for the sake of truth. Thousands of martyrs who have lived are a unique phenomenon in the history of our solar system." Rachel Scott, USA, 1999. Rachel Scott was one of the martyrs killed at Columbine High School on April 20th, 1999. Rachel's faith in Christ was no secret to her peers in Littleton, Colorado, which made her a target. That fateful day when Eric Harris and Dylan Klebold opened fire at their high school, Rachel was asked by the gunman if she believed in Christ. And when she answered in the affirmative, she was shot. Minutes later, they returned to her as she lay lying on the ground wounded and asked a second time if she still believed. On answering yes, she was shot in the head. 1 year before she was killed, Rachel wrote these prophetic words in her journal. This will be my last year, Lord. I have gotten what I can. Thank you. If I have to sacrifice everything for you, I will. Martin Burnham, Philippines, 2002. In 2001, Muslim terrorists in the southern Philippines kidnapped New Tribes missionaries Martin and Graysa Burnham. They were held in captivity, constantly being shuttled from one hiding place to another. After 13 months on the move, the guerrillas knew that government troops sent to rescue the Burnhams were closing in on them. Each night, the Burnhams slept in a tent pitched between them and the direction the guerrillas thought the government attack would come from. When it finally happened, the missionaries were caught in the crossfire. Graysa was wounded in the thigh while Martin was hit in the chest. He died with his body partially covering his wife's. Martin Burnham had a premonition that he would not survive their long captivity, but his faith never wavered. When other hostages were praying to be released, Martin prayed, "Thank you, Lord." He and Graysa knew the risks when they went to the Philippines. They were prepared to sacrifice their lives for the cause of Christ.
My life apart, all this world reveals and pours through. All I once thought gained, I have counted loss, spent in worthless now compared. Knowing you,
I pray even now that Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. I am hard-pressed from both directions, having the desire to depart and to be with Christ, for that is much better. Yet to remain on is more necessary for your sake, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, in order that I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. For our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, by the working of the power he has, even to subject all things unto himself.
Come stand in the light, the glory
Father, take my life. Yes, my blood, if thou wilt. Countless martyrs throughout the history of Christianity have echoed Jim Elliot's words of commitment. They were able to do so because of Christ's great victory at the cross. Christ is risen from the dead, trampling over death by death. And our God is not dead, he's alive. It's because of Christ, because of what he's done, we can face tomorrow. It's because of Christ that he lives, all fear is gone. It's because we know that he holds the future, our lives are worth the living, just because he lives. Christ is not only risen and alive, he is Lord. He stands over and above all that is best in life as its source. He stands above all that is worst as its ultimate victor. He stands above all powers and authorities as judge. He stands above all failure and weakness as sin, as forgiveness and love. O church, come stand in the light and proclaim Christ's great victory. Christ, you alone are worthy of our total allegiance, our total commitment. You alone are God. As your bride, we lift up our hearts and bring you our sacrifice of praise. As your beloved, we lift up our voices and sing you our hymns of worship, praise and honor and glory and might to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb forever and ever. Amen.
Let's sing with great joy and bring honor to our Lord. Stand and join with me.
Oh,
Yeah, stay standing if you would and take the hand of the person next to you. As I lead you in the prayer that Christ taught his followers to pray, join with me, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I say, Christ is risen. You respond by saying, truly, he is risen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. So go in the power of the risen Christ and change the world for him. Amen.
We hope you enjoyed this message. Biola University offers a variety of biblically centered degree programs, ranging from business to ministry to the arts and sciences. Learn more at biola.edu.